Saga Egmont presents The Fear of Falling by John Harkin, read by Neil McFarlane. For Jacqueline. Farewell to all the feelings that expand the heart. I have been heaven's substitute to recompense the good. Now the god of vengeance yields to me his power to punish the wicked. Alexandre Dumas, The Count of Monte Cristo. Chapter 1, August 1957. It started with the promise of homemade fudge. The four children, dressed in t-shirts and shorts, were sitting at the edge of the common close, shaded from a sweltering hot afternoon. Florence and Grace swapping paper scraps on the steps. Lucas and Robert were swapping some of their Batman and Superman comics. Florence had some lovely scraps. Bright-coloured, die-cut angel figures in the Victorian style. Grace had some embossed kittens in her neatly maintained scrapbook. The girls were swapping some of their doublers. "Fresh fudge, children!" their neighbour, Mrs. Wilson, shouted from the open bay window of her top-floor tenement flat. The lure of sweets was irresistible, and four hungry seven-year-olds gathered up their comics and scrapbooks and hurried up three flights of tenement stairs. Jeannie Wilson was a long-widowed, retired primary school teacher in her early 70s, and one of the long-term residents in the street. She'd been serving up homemade fudge to the local kids for years. In recent months, Mrs. Wilson hadn't been seen much in the neighbourhood. Once, she'd been a regular sight with her two-wheeled tartan shopping trolley. Now she struggled with the tenement stairs. There had been recent complaints from the next door and downstairs neighbours about her playing piano in the wee small hours, and some families had warned their kids to stay clear of the eccentric old woman. She greeted the children warmly. The sweet, enticing smell of freshly made fudge floated towards them through the open door. "Come in, my little angels, come in." Mrs. Wilson, in a cardigan and housecoat, seemed overdressed for the hot weather. Lucas noticed a film of sweat on her brow. She ushered them into the living room, past an upright piano, towards a folding dining table that held a large tray of fudge. The large middle bay sash window was fully raised, a gentle breeze blowing the net curtains back into the room. "Now, children, God has given us a beautiful, bright summer's day, and before you eat this lovely fudge, I want you to see the angels out in the sky."
"I've got angels in my scrapbook, Mrs. Wilson," said an excited Florence.
The cute little blonde-haired girl ran to the window and pressed her nose to the glass, examining the blue skies for traces of the heavenly beings. "If you stand up on the windowsill and stare out into the glorious heavenly sky, I promise you'll see the angels." Mrs. Wilson had placed an old footstool at the window. "I want the little girls first, then the boys." She helped tiny Florence up onto the ledge of the closed left-hand bay window, then Grace, then Lucas, and finally Robert. As the ledge became busier, Florence had to shuffle along towards the larger open middle window. The cool air served as a warning.
"Mrs. Wilson, that's dangerous," Lucas shouted. "You need to close that window."
"You cheeky wee devil, you won't see any angels."
Mrs. Wilson was ushering the children along to the point where Florence now stood on the ledge of the large open window. Lucas edged past Grace in an attempt to get to Florence, but before he could reach her, Mrs. Wilson pushed her out. Robert and Grace froze in terror, too petrified to move. Lucas was horrified, but knew he had to act.
"No, no, get down, Grace."
Lucas snatched at the flapping net curtain. Mrs. Wilson lunged, pushing him. He got enough purchase on the curtains with his hands to swing his foot up, making solid contact with Mrs. Wilson's mouth, knocking her over. As the curtains came away in his hands, Mrs. Wilson's shocked face and her shriek of anguish were the last things he saw and heard before he fell. The eerie sensation of no ground beneath his feet. He flailed around, trying to grab something or find a foothold in the merciless, empty air. As he hurtled towards the ground, his eyes wide open in terror, took in the clear blue sky. They had been promised angels. In the nightmares that followed, Lucas fell again and again. Each dreamed descent was longer, extending the fall to an interminable duration. He felt the same sickening sensation as the ground rose to meet him, convinced that this time, surely, the fall would kill him, as it had killed her. But it never did. As he lay broken in his neighbour's garden, he saw the pretty roses, the same shade as the slick red halo forming on the concrete garden path around Florence's head. Lucas's broken femur would heal relatively quickly, but it was the psychological scars from the incident that would linger much longer through his life. After the event, many families and neighbours chatted about the obvious physical and mental decline in old Jeannie Wilson. All that isolation, the late-night piano playing, someone should have noticed that her mind was going. The confused old woman would live out her remaining years in the mental hospital. The wee boy, Lucas, he was the hero of the piece, saving his two pals from going out the window. Lucas didn't feel like a hero. His young, troubled soul was tormented by grief and guilt, emotions he couldn't fully comprehend. In his first 2 years of primary school, Lucas had been a bright, friendly, and jovial little boy. But in the early months of primary three, his teacher saw a dramatic change. Haunted, he withdrew from his classmates and struggled to concentrate on his lessons. It was Lucas's mother, Maggie, who arranged the intervention that would help her son find a path back towards a normal childhood. The parish priest, Father Owens, suggested that Lucas might benefit from a session with the Sisters of Notre Dame, who operated a child psychology unit in Down Hill. It was on the other side of the city from the family home in the Gorbals, and involved an underground train ride to Hill Head in Glasgow's Douce West End. Working with the nuns would be a long shot, but Maggie was willing to try anything to get her bright, happy boy back. 6 subway stops and a short walk away, Downhill was like another world. The leafy West End starkly contrasted with the grim, grey, crumbling tenements of the Gorbals. The nuns of the Notre Dame convent were kindness personified, especially when they heard the story of the young child thrown from a tenement window. One of the senior nuns, Sister Jude, greeted the pair and noted the full background to Lucas's situation. She explained that he would be assessed and a dedicated educational therapist would help him work on his issues. Sister Jude introduced Lucas to Sister Marie Therese. She was young with rosy cheeks, a big wide smile and bright blue eyes. It took Lucas a while to get used to her wimple, but Sister Marie Therese put him at ease very quickly with her kind and patient manner. While Lucas played in a sandpit and made plaster cast models, Sister Jude gave Maggie a tour of the expansive Notre Dame complex, including the teacher training college, where the Montessori training methods they used were explained. By the time she returned, Lucas was playing happily, and he presented his mother with a hand-painted model of Pinocchio. In the following weeks, over a total of 8 half-day sessions, Sister Marie Therese, with a mix of patience, persistence, and kindness, won the trust and confidence of Lucas, who looked forward to his weekly appointments. He told her about his nightmares and how he fell again and again in his sleep and woke up crying, haunted by the image of his dead friend. In week 4, they had a breakthrough. Lucas was grieving that he hadn't reached Florence in time to save her, so it was wrong for people to call him a hero. Recognizing the acute survivor guilt that the child was experiencing, Sister Marie Therese asked him about his favourite superhero, Superboy. She tasked him with painting a picture of Superboy, and when he was finished, she asked him a question. Can Superboy save everybody?
He's Superboy.
But he can't be everywhere at the same time. So, he can't save everyone. Even God can't save everyone. The nun spoke softly, slowly, and deliberately. God couldn't save your friend Florence, so we took her up to heaven to be with him. Lucas began to sob. She looked into the sweet little boy's handsome face, his pale green eyes filling with tears. Lucas, you saved Grace and Robert. The nun held his hand. You'll always be a hero to those two. You did your very, very best, and no one can ask any more of you. Not me, not you, and not God. Now in your picture, is he fallen or flying?
He's flying, he's Superboy.
Lucas was certain.
What if he was falling?
What if he had just been exposed to kryptonite and was falling out of the sky?
You know about kryptonite, Sister Marie-Thérèse. You're great.
Imagine you're Superboy and you're falling out of the sky. When you get far enough away from the kryptonite, you feel your flying superpower kick back in and then, zoom, you're flying. The nun closed her eyes, clutched the crucifix around her neck with one hand, and held Lucas's hand with the other. I want you to close your eyes, Lucas. Imagine you're Superboy, and when you're falling too close to the ground, you just zoom off and fly up to the sky again. They tried it twice together, then Lucas tried it three times on his own. In his mind's eye, he was flying above the ground. The next time you dream of falling, or even think of falling, I want you to imagine you can fly. She extended her arms to demonstrate. Just like your picture. And it worked. On his subsequent visits, Lucas reported that in all of his dreams, he could fly upwards into the sky before he hit the ground. In the years that followed, there was no falling in his dreams, only flying. Chapter 2, February 1987, Friday evening.
What about those two?
Barry nodded towards the two women making their way up the steep hill on Scott Street. They'll not get into the club.
Too drunk?
Paul was curious as to how his friend knew so much about the Cotton Club's door policy.
Nah, the skinny one in double denim won't get past the bouncers, Barry replied. She's a bit underdressed for that club, and for this weather.
Barry had parked the car in Sucky Hall Street, with a good view up the hill, and the bright lights of the nightclub entrance allowed them to watch the knockback happen. They saw the two women's animated pleading with the door stewards, but it wasn't happening for them. Not tonight, girls. Glasgow. The city of the last-minute lumber. No need to walk the boulevard of broken dreams on the weekend up the Toon. Opportunities were everywhere, if you knew where to look. Even on a freezing cold February night, the icy weather wasn't putting off the punters and partygoers in search of a last-chance lumber. Young women, unsuitably dressed for the low temperatures, moved between the bars, diners, and clubs. Well, if you'd spent a serious chunk of your pay packet on a new top from Bus Stop, Chelsea Girl, or Selfridges, you wouldn't want to cover it up with an overcoat. Dear old Glasgow Toon. The two forlorn figures turned and headed back down the hill, allowing their observers a closer look. The skinny one had faded blue jeans and a white denim jacket. Her friend wore a black fur jacket over a button-fronted dark blue wool dress, thick black tights, and long black winter boots.
Right, if this is a goer, I want the big diesel burner in the fur jacket.
Barry made his preference clear.
Look, Barry, I just came out for a beer. I'm done with all this malarkey. I'm getting married in the summer.
But you're not a married man yet. Come on. Favourite of me.
You're asking me to go with that scrawny thing.
Let's see how it plays out.
The two women were approaching the car. Barry wound down his driver's window.
No joy, ladies.
Barry flashed his best smile. He was a 32-year-old divorcee with a pleasant face and a neat side parting in his light brown hair.
Bloody knockback, would you believe it?
Fur Jacket told them what they already knew. The Cotton Club, until recently called Maestro's, was one of Glasgow's premier nightclubs, known for its strict weekend door policy.
I'm Barry, and this is Paul. You fancy a coffee?
We were going to head up to the club for a few beers, but if you want, we can keep you company, go for a bite, and then get you home. Barry laid out their offer. The two women stepped back from the car for a short confab.
Can I jump in front with you?
Fur Jacket made her selection known. It was a yes. Barry beamed. Paul tried to muster up some enthusiasm. They drove through the city. Glasgow didn't need an audition to be a film noir location. Driving through the city at night, the grey buildings and dim sodium street lighting evoked an image of nitrate film prints casting grainy light and shade on the magnificent Victorian architecture. The city's wines and vennels conjured up a black-and-white movie screening in some dark, smoke-filled cinema. They drove through the merchant city, the dark heart of the second city of the empire, built on tobacco, weaving, commerce, and the buying and selling of slaves. A shimmer of frost made the city streets sparkle with the monochromatic resonance of an Oscar Marzaroli print. They crossed the Clyde and headed for a popular drive-up greasy spoon joint south of the river. Fur Jacket introduced herself as Claire. Her friend was Ellie. They were chatty, not drunk, but they'd had a few drinks. Paul took the order for burgers, chips, teas and coffees and joined a small queue at the counter of the large white trailer. The smell of cooked meat permeated the cold night air. Paul eyed two drunk youths who'd taken ages with their order, larking about with the oversized mustard dispenser. The taller one squirted the bottle at his pal, but some of the yellow paste landed on Paul's jacket sleeve.
What the fuck?
Paul grabbed the boy by the throat, pressing him back against the trailer.
It was an accident, big man,
the second youth pushed between them.
I'm sorry, pal. Let me pay for your dry cleaning,
the perpetrator said, fumbling in his jeans for some money once Paul had let go of his throat. Barry sprang out of the car and led the two youths away from the scene. He gave them a piece of his mind, pointing his finger into their faces and ushering them away. Paul and Barry returned to the car with the food and drink.
What was all that about?
Claire asked.
That stupid Ned splattered mustard on my suit, Paul replied. I think I got most of it off with a paper towel and some hot water. Hopefully no lasting damage and no smell.
Paul laughed.
I hate mustard, Claire said.
Over stewed tea, scalding hot coffee and tasteless hamburgers, the four of them made easy small talk, chatting about Glasgow's various pubs and clubs and what they did for a living. Claire was the lady's hairdresser, with plans to one day own her own salon in Pollock, where they both stayed. She was curvy, with a lot of cleavage on show under her jacket. The more outgoing of the two, she ran her hand through her long, thick mane of black hair and did most of the talking. She made jokes about having a big bust and how difficult it made it for her to cut customers' hair. Ellie was wraith-like skinny, with short-cut, straw-blonde hair, pretty blue eyes and a shy smile. She said that she knew they were on a knockback from the club because of the way she was dressed. The dancing had been an afterthought after a night's drinking in the Iron Horse, but they were grateful for some hot food and a run home on such a freezing night. She talked about her work in a bakery. The aroma of half-cooked burger meat was overpowering the waning pine scent of the car's magic tree air freshener.
That's actually pretty vile, Barry said.
He tossed his half-eaten burger through his open window. Barry explained they were both car salesmen, working for a major Vauxhall dealership in the city. That fitted with their appearance, smart suits and open-neck shirts. En route to Pollock, Barry detoured to a remote area known locally as the Barhead Dams. The dams had been established to provide a clean water supply to the rapidly developing Gorbals district on the south side of the River Clyde, and covered a vast area of green space around the East Renfrewshire and Glasgow city boundary. The three massive reservoirs and their gravitational water system stood as a lasting testament to Victorian engineering. Barry Rogers wasn't thinking about Victorian engineering as he drove along the myriad networks of country roads that linked Barhead, Neilston, Darnley and Newton Mearns. The headlights of Barry's 1982 Ford Escort provided the only illumination on the dark and narrow roads as he searched for the perfect spot. Barry knew his route. He'd driven these roads many times. A single-track road on the south side of the vast Balgrey Reservoir was the ideal spot. Barry kept the car heater running as he stopped in a lay-by. Both couples started kissing. Claire clambered over the center console to sit astride Barry. In no time, he had unbuttoned the front of her dress and unhooked her bra. She seemed untroubled by the two observers in the back. Paul and Ellie were getting it on at a much slower pace and were both distracted by the passion being ramped up in the front seats. Paul slipped his hand under Ellie's blouse and played with her erect nipples. She rubbed his hard cock through his suit trousers. He unzipped her denims and slipped his fingers inside her knickers. Ellie wriggled and moaned in the back seat. They were catching up with their friends. Barry grew more annoyed as Claire occasionally stopped to glimpse what was happening in the back. These checks unsettled Ellie, as she suddenly pushed Paul off, zipped up her fly, and opened her door.
I'm going for a walk. Come on, Ellie, it's Baltic out there.
He was in no mood to follow her. Claire and Barry stopped. She leaned over the seat.
She wants you to go where? Go where? It's absolutely freezing out there.
You can't stay here.
It was Barry, twisting his head around to speak through the gap in the front seats. He made a face that said, get the fuck out of this car, now.
You can't sit there watching us like some pervert.
Claire sat upright, pulling her dress over her breasts to restore some modesty. She urgently wanted to resume her session.
We can just go get her and head home, Paul said.
No, you go and get her.
Two voices in unison. With no desire to be a captive audience to the heavy foreplay in the front seats, Paul heard the clinking sound of a penny drop in his skull and realized he only had one option.
I'll catch her up.
He opened the car door and shuddered as the freezing night air flooded the car's interior before walking off into the darkness. Chapter 3. Two uniformed figures took up a position in the heart of the junction, observing the patrons as they spilled out of the bar at closing time. The Granite City Inn was one of the first stops for the Gorbals police patrols on the night shift beat. The pub, one of the few to survive the district's tenement cull, was a Gorbals institution, notorious in police circles for drunkenness, disorder, and sporadic violence. Its situation at the five-way intersection formed by Pollockshaws Road, Cathcart Road, Gorbals Street, and Cumberland Street was at the very heart of the Gorbals district. The two cops were busy shepherding large groups of revellers leaving the pub in various states of drunkenness. It was an anti-disorder patrol. The Granite attracted patrons from all across the city as the Gorbals diaspora was drawn back to their old watering holes. Many came from the sprawling Southside Castlemilk housing estate, the principal reason for the police presence at the junction. The drunken clamour and potential disorder caused by those catching the last number 37 bus home was the subject of a standing complaint from the bus operators. Constable Chrissy McCartney marvelled at the way her more experienced colleague handled the crowd. Peter Costello had seen it all, or most of it, before.
Can you get us a police taxi, big man?
An inebriated teenager asked. Costello laughed and pointed out the obvious flaw in the request.
Police taxis only run to the police station, and I don't think you want to spend the weekend there.
The big cop's booming, gravelly voice rose above the crowd.
Hey, doll, can I have your phone number?
Another drunk chanced his arm with McCartney.
I've already got a boyfriend.
It was her stock reply. You're not my type, was another, although a stern glare from Costello would also dissuade would-be suitors. Chrissy knew that other cops at the station would handle this group differently. Inebriated young men didn't need much of a push towards confrontation, and Costello had shown her expertly how to walk that line. She was very glad he was beside her. McCartney was 24, a former bank clerk from leafy suburban Bear's Den. The contrast between her previous occupation and current role could hardly be more marked, but she loved the variety, the challenge, and occasional excitement that police work offered. Costello and McCartney observed the pub crowd mingling around the pavement outside the bar. Occasionally, a patron, the worse for drink, would stray onto the busy roadway, only to be steered to safety by Costello. A number would wander around finishing off their drinks, pint glasses in hand. Costello took a stricter line here. A pint tumbler could do a lot of damage in a fight. Transgressors were sternly warned to return the glasses to the pub or face charges. Peter Costello stood 6'5" in his socks. Very few argued with him. Chrissy McCartney knew that the secret to a happy work life was having a good neighbour, and she had one of the best going. In Glasgow police parlance, the term neighbour denoted a partner. She'd been neighboured up with Costello for around 18 months and enjoyed being his sidekick. They were chalk and cheese. He was into books, classical music, and old Hollywood movies. She liked nightclubs and was into U2, Michael Jackson, and Prince, but they worked as a partnership. With 5.5 years' service, McCartney had learned more working with Costello than she had in the previous 4 years. She was happy to put up with all of his war stories and tales of the old Gorbals.
"You know why the Granite has survived when so many other Gorbals pubs have been demolished?" Costello asked.
"The fact that it's built into the railway bridge, maybe," McCartney laughed. "I think you may have mentioned it previously." Costello had also insisted on instructing his neighbour on the history of the area's pubs. The old Gorbals was legendary for the number of public houses in the district. Most of them had been demolished over the last 30 years.
"Are you going to start listing all the pubs that have disappeared?" McCartney asked with a cheeky grin. "Only the ones I've taken a dram in," the big cop laughed.
Costello had regaled McCartney with stories about his early days as a Gorbals constable, when the entire night shift would be dispatched to oversee throwing out time. Their efforts were appreciated by the staff, landlords and licensees. No one wanted to fall foul of the strict licensing laws governing opening hours, underage drinking and drunkenness. Once the patrons had left and the doors were locked, appreciation was shown to the officers by way of a generous measure of whisky. "I'm pleased the police drinking culture is dying out," McCartney said. It wasn't why she joined up. A scuffle broke out near the bus stop. McCartney pushed through a group of revelers and got between the two teenage protagonists.
"You want to get the bus home or ride a police van back to the station and lie in all weekend?" McCartney asked the young men, who were both the worse for drink.
Costello stayed close to his neighbour, but she didn't require any assistance from him. She was a little terrier who got stuck in. The two youths took the tiny policewoman's advice and crept quietly away from the scene. Just south of their location was Gushet Falls, a historical Gorbals landmark, the name surviving from when it accommodated a public water fountain. Half a mile north was Gorbals Cross, which marked the boundary with the river and the city centre. When Costello started out as a young beat constable, there were more than 20 hostelries dotted between the Gushet and the Cross. The Citizen, the Seaforth, the Cumberland Arms, and many, many more. A small number, including Dixon's Blazes, Derry Trainers, and the Govanhill Bar, had survived as final remnants of the old Gorbals. The buildings that housed them had been lost to the post-war annihilation of the Glasgow tenement, demolished to make way for a new Gorbals. Communities in the sky with high-rise towers or damp, poorly constructed flats. But those last few surviving bars had endured the tenement cull. They stood as lone structures, dominating the barren brown dirt landscapes of their surroundings, like oases in a post-apocalyptic urban wasteland. Costello had lived in the neighbourhood as a young boy. His family had stayed in a tenement close in Crown Street, just along from the Dixon's Blazes. The pub had been named after the Dixon's Govan Ironworks, which, for over 100 years, had lit up the night sky south of the River Clyde with the red glow of the fire and fumes from its 5 blast furnaces. Today, the site, once nicknamed Dixon's Blazes, was a vast cash-and-carry warehouse. A gangly young man broke into a run, his sudden movement starting a commotion in the crowd. He was stopped in his tracks by a large hand on his shoulder.
"Sammy boy," Costello asked, "where are you off to in such a hurry?"
"I'm sorry, Mr. Costello," Sammy replied. "I was just trying to catch up with my mates."
With his massive height and build, a full head of white hair and a ruggedly handsome face, Costello was a familiar sight in the area. He was one of the longest-serving officers at the station, and his local knowledge was second to none. He knew all the criminals, or Neds, as they were termed by cops, all the various interconnections across and between families, their residences, their vehicles. He was a one-man criminal intelligence system for the area. Local intel was so important in the age-old battle between Polis and Neds, and Costello was a major contributor to the fight. If McCartney had one complaint, it was that Costello was overprotective of her, often taking charge of situations where he felt she may be threatened or harmed. It was understandable. He was self-confessed old school, and his actions were motivated by noble intents. He was the father of two teenage daughters, and his protective instincts kicked in when he worked with McCartney. It was partly due to his physical presence. He was a giant, she was a petite 5'6". She'd had that difficult conversation with her neighbour, and his response had reassured her. After their chat, she saw a marked change in Costello's behaviour, and he allowed McCartney to take the lead in many incidents. Costello and McCartney were not the only ones watching the crowd. High above them, a dark figure stood sentinel, observing the two constables policing the group and shepherding drinkers towards the bus stop. The man in the shadows wouldn't be making any moves while the police were in the vicinity. The old abandoned City Union Bridge that abuts the rear of the Granite City Inn provided him with a perfect vantage point. The trains didn't run there anymore since the demolition of the Grand St. Enoch's railway station and hotel back in the late 70s. Up above the streetlights, he could see but not be seen. Dressed in an ankle-length black leather coat over a black hooded top, the darkness wrapped around him like a cloak. He knew the big cop, Costello, a legend when he was a teenager, but it wasn't the police officer who concerned him tonight. The man he was interested in was not bound for Castlemilk with the jostling queue at the crowded bus stop, but for the Hutchison Town district of the Gorbals. He caught sight of his prey. Colin Waters was wearing a distinctive, cream-coloured Harrington jerkin and was alongside a second man who he knew only as Moser from the nearby High Flats. Both men looked the worse for drink as they stood chatting by the side of the road. With the Castlemilk bus queue safely dispatched, the police headed away along Gorbals Street as the crowd thinned to smaller groups and stragglers making their way home. Moving cautiously, he descended the disused staircase adjacent to the sandstone railway arches on the side of the bridge. Keeping Waters in his sightline, he watched as the two men said their exaggerated, drunken goodbyes. Moser sloped off towards the High Flats entrance, leaving Waters, his gait unsteady, heading home. Colin Waters was scum. He completed full research on his target and was in no doubt about the reliability of his information. He checked it and double-checked it. Waters was a drug dealer who'd destroyed hundreds of lives from the school gates to the street corners. He was also a shitebag. Waters wasn't known for his fighting ability. He made his name by putting in the hours. Cannabis and heroin available any time of the day, the former peddled as a gateway drug into the latter. Waters relied on others for his protection. Tonight, there'd be none. Now at street level, he started to close the distance between him and his prey. Waters would have to cut through the derelict E-block of low-rise flats to get home. He quickened his pace, adjusting his clothing. Black beanie hat and hoodie, a black scarf covering his mouth, so that the only visible part of his face was his eyes. Eyes burning with anger. When Waters entered the foyer of his flat, he was already standing there, waiting for him in the shadows. The faint smell of urine, discarded drugs paraphernalia, and the graffiti-marked walls were all too familiar. "Excuse me, big man." Waters' speech was slurred. His path was blocked. The tall black-clad figure was still and silent.
"Get out of my way, pal," Waters said.
"I'm going nowhere, Waters."
He opened his coat and with a well-practiced flourish drew a long-bladed silver katana, which he brandished under Waters' astonished face.
"Come on, man, what's the score? You want some gear?"
He steadied himself by grabbing hold of the staircase banister. He bristled at the mention of drugs.
"That's why I'm here, but not in the way you think."
In an expert posture, he wielded the sword two-handed and with great fluidity in his wrists, swung it up, around and down on his target, slicing off Waters' right hand. Waters let out an anguished, high-pitched scream and fell to his knees next to his severed, bleeding hand. Paralyzed by shock, a dazed and confused Waters held the stump of his right hand in his left. He was howling like a wounded animal. Cowering, terrified, he looked up at his attacker.
"What the fuck? What was that for?"
Waters managed to utter through his pain.
"That's justice for all the lives you've destroyed." You can tell Phil Canavan I'm coming for him next.
Who the fuck are you?
Colour draining from his face and blood pumping from his stump, Waters was sprawled on the damp grey concrete, looking up at his attacker's cold blue eyes, staring impassively.
Tell him the Gorbal Samurai is coming for him.
He pressed the tip of his sword into Waters' neck and laughed as he replaced the katana back in its saya, the scabbard concealed inside his coat. It was a hollow, terrible laugh. Chapter 4. Barry and Claire were enjoying a post-coital cigarette, both front windows open a little to let the smoke out. The back door opened. Paul stuck his face into the rear seat space.
Where's Ellie?
Paul's question took them both by surprise.
Very funny. I take it you caught her up.
Barry led the laughter with Claire joining in, both clearly expecting to see Ellie appear from behind his back.
Seriously, did she not come back?
Paul's tone was apprehensive.
That crazy girl, she's always pulling shit like this.
Claire seemed unsurprised.
She's probably walked back to a main road and hailed a taxi home.
I obviously walked off in the wrong direction, but to be fair, it was pitch dark outside. I couldn't see my hand in front of my face. I stayed away from the car as long as I could to give you a chance to finish what you were doing.
Let's go and see if we can pick her back up en route.
But she's got about 20 minutes on us, Barry said. Barry drove full tilt, quickly picking up the roadway. A short distance later, as he manoeuvred a sweeping bend, his full-beam headlights picked out the figure of a woman lying on the ground in a lay-by. Ellie Hunter's white denim jacket and faded blue jeans were unmistakable. Claire shrieked in horrified recognition as the twin cones of white light illuminated her friend's body.
What have you done to Ellie?
I swear, I haven't seen her since she left this car, Paul replied. All three hurried from the vehicle and rushed to her side. A light film of frost covered Ellie's clothing as they knelt beside her on the frozen ground. There was no blood or obvious sign of injuries. Illuminated by the car headlights, Barry took hold of her arm, trying to establish a pulse. He noticed heavy scarring on both her wrists.
She's freezing cold, but I think I've found a pulse, Barry said.
Move aside, you're using your thumb, let me try.
Paul leaned in closer to Ellie and slowly tracked the middle and forefinger of his right hand across her right wrist. He, too, noticed the heavy scarring.
There's a very faint pulse, but we need to get her to a hospital, ASAP.
Paul traced a stronger pulse in her neck to confirm that she was still alive.
What did you do to her?
Claire shouted non-stop at Paul.
Wake up, Ellie, wake up!
She grabbed her friend's shoulders, shaking her and gently slapping her face, to no avail.
I'll say it again to be clear. I haven't seen her since she left the car. This is no time to be hysterical. We need to get her to a doctor.
The two men lifted Ellie's frozen, limp body into the rear seat of the car. Her slight frame took little effort. Barry carried her by the head and shoulders and noticed a speck of blood on the collar of her white denim jacket. There was a tiny red smudge on her neck. Claire then sat with her, holding Ellie in her lap, her legs laid out across the back seat. She caressed her face, softly speaking her name, in an attempt to revive her. Barry closed the rear car door on the two women and pulled Paul to the side for a whispered discussion.
What happened with you two?
Are you dense? I never saw her after she left the car. Do you think I'd leave her lying there like that?
There's a wee bit of blood on her jacket collar and her neck, Barry said.
Paul inspected his right hand and saw a small nick on the ball of his thumb.
And that must have happened just now when I was searching for her pulse.
He lifted the wound to his mouth and sucked away the excess blood. I slipped on the ice on my way back to the car.
Did you clock her wrists? Barry asked.
Yeah, self-harmer. Clear sign of suicidal tendencies. Typical that I end up with a nutcase. Let's get her heated up in the car. Maybe she'll come too en route to the hospital.
Right. I'm Raymond and you're Pat, okay?
Barry had a plan.
Let's just get her to a doctor.
Both men jumped back into the front seats.
Royal Alexandra and Paisley is the closest A&E and we can't afford to wait around for an ambulance.
Barry gripped the wheel with new urgency and gunned the accelerator on a route through Barhead.
How's she doing?
Keep talking to her and maybe she'll come round. Pat reckons she must have got hit by a car. He threw some shade on the narrative.
She's warmed up a wee bit and she's still breathing. That's the main thing.
Claire continued to stroke Ellie's face. Paul turned around and looked directly at Claire. I noticed that Ellie's got old scarring on her wrists. Does she have suicidal tendencies?
She had some issues years ago, but she's fine now. She's always been a bit of a flake.
Her walking off into the night like that wasn't too much of a surprise to you? Paul asked.
It's the kind of stuff she does, Claire replied, stroking her unconscious friend's hair.
When we get to casualty, can we just say she got knocked down in a hit-and-run accident? Pat never saw her again. Barry was thinking a step ahead.
We don't know what happened. Let's see what the doctors say, Paul replied.
We can say she got out of the car to do a pee and slipped on the ice and banged her head. Barry was thinking out loud now as he sped towards the hospital.
When she wakes up, she'll tell us what happened, Claire said. Why do you want to make shit up?
What have I done? Paul never spoke the words, but the question dominated his thoughts. His stomach was roiling at the prospect of what might happen next. The dams to the Royal Alexandra Hospital was a 15-minute drive. Barry completed the journey in 10. He brought the car to an abrupt halt outside the A&E entrance amid a fleet of waiting ambulances. Paul ran into the main reception, alerting staff to the arrival of an unconscious woman. A young porter wearing a brown lab coat rushed to help Paul and Barry lift Ellie from the car to a trolley and directed Claire to the reception desk to provide the patient's details. A&E was busy. Two uniformed policemen were in the waiting area, noting witness details from the family member of a young man admitted with a bleeding head injury. Claire approached the officer, who wasn't writing in his notebook. He looked the senior of the two.
Excuse me, can I have a word, please?
The cop ushered Claire to a quieter corner of reception. It was clear to Barry and Paul that she was recounting the events prior to Ellie's hospital admittance. Barry motioned to Paul in the waiting area.
We should really get out of here, bud.
We can't just run off. We need to wait with Claire a bit, see if they can revive her. They fell silent as the police officer approached with Claire in tow. Gentlemen, what can you tell me about the young woman you just brought here? The constable spoke directly to Paul.
I can't add any more to what you've probably heard from Claire. Ellie left the car and I next saw her 20 minutes after that when I picked her up off the ground.
Paul held up both hands in a half shrug. Barry shot the cop a sceptical glance. He went to his inside jacket pocket and produced a slim black folding wallet. He flicked it open to show his warrant card.
I'm Detective Constable Barry Rogers, Gorbals CID. This is my colleague, DC Paul Kennedy.
Chapter 5. Saturday. As the on-call duty DI for Paisley, Ronnie Miller always half expected his home phone to ring in the wee small hours on weekends. It was unusual for a Friday and Saturday night to pass without a call out for the duty dog. His night shift DS, Jerry Whelan, had briefed him over the phone to confirm that two F Division detectives had been detained at the hospital and would be conveyed to Paisley Police Office with a female witness. Whelan, a very competent investigator and experienced supervisor, knew that the identity of the two detainees would have telephones ringing all over the force. This one would quickly escalate above his pay grade. Whelan updated Miller on the latest medical notice. The victim, now confirmed as 22-year-old Ellie Hunter, was still unconscious. The initial diagnosis had found a fractured skull with a suspected subdural hematoma. Whelan's best effort at translating the medicalese was that a fracture had caused bleeding on the brain and she'd probably need surgery. Ellie Hunter was in dire straits. Miller walked his DS through a detailed set of instructions. The car, the place where it was initially parked, the lay-by, the victim, her hair and clothing, and Paul Kennedy himself were all to be treated as multiple crime scenes and subject to full forensic examination and analysis. DS Whelan seized Hunter's clothing at the RAH, where the medics pointed out the bloodstain on her jacket and the smudge on her neck. Ronnie Miller was a meticulous investigator by nature, but with police officers involved as a suspect and a witness, this case would need to withstand the highest levels of scrutiny. He would not be found wanting.
Barry Rogers' Ford Escort left the hospital atop a low loader, destined for the forensic vehicle bay at Paisley Police Office. Paul Kennedy's clothing was seized for forensic examination, and his hands were bagged and sealed until swabs and blood samples could be taken by the on-call force casualty surgeon. Claire Travers' statement was noted by a female detective. Barry Rogers and Paul Kennedy, who was now wearing a white paper evidence suit, had to endure the humiliation of sitting in separate glass-fronted detention rooms adjacent to the uniform bar at the back office. Kennedy sat on the bench with his head in his hands, trying to avoid the stares of police officers walking past. Rogers stood at the glass-paneled door, trying to attract the attention of a custody officer. No one went near him. They'd been warned by the duty inspector to steer clear. Once all the main players were safely located at Paisley office, Miller's first order of business was to examine the locus. D.S. Whelan rescued Rogers from his detention room hell, and with Miller in the back seat, they set off in a CID pool car to the lay-by where Ellie Hunter was found. The atmosphere in the car was as frosty as the early morning air. Miller broke the silence.
"I'm told the girl's in a bad way. How the hell did this happen?"
"I've no idea, boss. I never got out of the car," Rogers replied.
"But Paul Kennedy was gone for around 15-20 minutes, Miller asked.
"Around that, yeah."
"Plenty of time for you to get your end away with the witness. Is that how it went?"
Rogers groaned.
"I think that's why he got out. He could hardly sit there and watch the two of us." "How long before he went after her? Remember, even though you're technically not under caution, you need to think hard about what you say here."
"I'm sure the girl Claire will say the same thing. It was a very short conversation with the three of us. A minute and a half."
"So no big gap between her leaving the car and him getting out?"
"Around 90 seconds or so, 2 minutes max." Rogers shifted in his seat.
"So very unlikely that whatever happened to her happened in that short time."
"Very unlikely, but I think they set off in different directions."
"Well, we'll see about that. Jenny will get a full statement from you when we get back to the office."
D.S. Whelan stopped the car at the lay-by where Ellie was found, leaving the full beam headlights on to illuminate the scene. The two Paisley detectives added their torch beams as Miller hunkered down to examine the ground. There was nothing obvious to suggest a struggle, but he was too astute an investigator to imagine that this constituted an effective or professional locus search. He would close the road at both ends and have the traffic department set up local diversions. Traffic examiners would inspect the scene to confirm or rule out a road traffic accident. Meantime, a uniformed patrol car would be posted to ensure no interference with the locus. At first light, he would arrange a full fingertip search by a support unit crew. Miller's experience had taught him to call upon the services of the men and women from Springburn with their police overalls, welly boots, rakes, poles, and professional search techniques. One divisional commander jokingly referred to them as the Peggy Spencer Formation Dance Team, but they would do the business. Detectives never liked to get their expensive Ralph Slater suits dirty. Back at the office, D.S. Whelan noted a statement from Rogers that backed up everything he'd already told them. Working from Claire Travers' initial account, Whelan asked him some pointed questions about what he saw as potentially incriminating behaviour. Pretending to be car salesman and approaching her to say Ellie had been the victim of a hit-and-run driver.
"Has D.C. Kennedy got a bit of a temper then?" D.S. Whelan asked.
"I wouldn't say that," Rogers replied.
"According to the witness, Claire Travers, Paul Kennedy attacked a young guy at the hamburger stall."
"Attacked is a bit strong," Rogers said. "The guy sprayed mustard in his suit."
"And he choked him for doing that?" Whelan asked.
"Oh, come on. It was two drunk Neds. We chased him down the road. There was nothing in it," Rogers replied.
"That's not what Claire Travers was thinking when she watched you from the car."
The DS also speared him with Travers' claim that he'd started calling Paul Kennedy by a different first name. Rogers admitted it all in his statement. It all sounded like a cover-up, and he knew it looked bad. His career would suffer after this episode. He'd probably get bounced back into a woolly suit or onto traffic duties.
"I never thought the girl was so badly injured. I just wanted to make sure that we were well out of it for when she woke up."
Rogers realised how shallow and heartless it all sounded.
He felt ashamed. They were police officers, for God's sake.
What if she never wakes up?
Whelan held his gaze. Rogers had to avert his eyes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.